Welcome to Renal Physiology series by Vipul Navadiya. We are studying tubular processing and in this video we will see transport of chloride. So let's start. Chloride is filtered freely at glomerulus. Its reabsorption is almost parallel to sodium reabsorption. So about 65% is reabsorbed in proximal tubule, 25% from ascending limb, 5% from distal tubule and 4% from collecting duct. About 1% is excreted in urine. Now let's see mechanisms involved. In proximal tubule, reabsorption occurs mainly by paracellular route. There are three factors driving it. These are electrical gradient in the initial part, solvent deck throughout the proximal tubule, and concentration gradient at the later part. Let's see them one by one. First, electrical gradient. In the initial part of proximal tubule, active transport of positively charged sodium ions from lumen into the interstitium makes lumen negative with respect to interstitium. This electrical gradient causes transport of negatively charged chloride from lumen into the interstitium by paracellular route. You can simply think of it as sodium is actively transported and chloride follows sodium due to electrical charge. Second, solvent drag. Active reabsorption of sodium and other solutes tend to decrease their luminal concentration and increase interstitial concentration. This creates osmolarity difference that causes osmosis of water from lumen into the interstitium. It occurs both by transcellular and paracellular route. Water moving by paracellular pathway carries solutes dissolved in it. Reabsorption by this process is referred to as solvent drag. Many solutes, including chloride, are reabsorbed in this way. Reabsorption by solvent drag occurs wherever the water is reabsorbed by paracellular route. Friends, please note one thing here. Water movement following osmotic change is so rapid that osmotic gradient doesn't rise much. Moving forward, although chloride is reabsorbed here, its proportion is less as compared to water. So chloride concentration increases in lumen. Moreover, as filtrate moves ahead in tubule, the concentration increases further and further because of the same reason. So, by end of the proximal tubule, chloride starts diffusing down this concentration gradient. And that is the mechanism of reabsorption by concentration gradient that I talked about earlier. Well, the sequence is not ending yet. In previous video, we left paracellular sodium reabsorption by late proximal tubule. Now it's time to learn it. See, here reabsorption of negatively charged chloride ions makes lumen positive. So sodium ions are repelled by this positivity and they move through the paracellular space into the interstitium. Simple. Now thin ascending limb. Here chloride reabsorption occurs passively by paracellular route. Luminal concentration of chloride is higher than interstitial. So chloride moves down this concentration gradient. Now let's go to the thick ascending limb. Entry at the luminal membrane occurs by sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter and exit at the basolateral membrane by chloride channels. These are the same transporters as we saw while learning the reabsorption of sodium. In distal tubule, apical entry occurs by sodium chloride cotransporter and basolateral exit by chloride channels. Reabsorption in collecting duct occurs by both paracellular and transcellular route. Let's see paracellular route first. It is similar to what happens in early part of proximal tubule. Reabsorption of positively charged sodium creates electronegativity inside the lumen. So chloride moves from lumen into the interstitium by paracellular route. Transcellular reabsorption is done by beta intercalated cells. Apical entry occurs by chloride bicarbonate exchanger and basolateral exit by chloride channels. To summarize it, proximal tubule reabsorbs 65% of chloride. It occurs entirely by paracellular route. Forces being electrical gradient in early proximal tubule, solvent drag throughout, and concentration gradient at the late proximal tubule. Ascending limb reabsorbs 25%. Luminal entry occurs by sodium potassium 2 chloride cotransporter and basolateral exit by chloride channels. Distal tubule reabsorbs 5%. Luminal entry occurs by sodium chloride cotransporter and basolateral exit by chloride channels. At collecting duct, 4% chloride is reabsorbed. Here paracellular reabsorption occurs due to lumen negative transepithelial electrical gradient. And transcellular reabsorption by beta intercalated cells involve chloride bicarbonate exchangers at the luminal membrane and chloride channels at the basolateral membrane. Finally, about 1% chloride is excreted in urine. So this was the transport of chloride. But before we close this video, I have something more to tell you. First, let me give you a tip on transepithelial electrical gradient throughout the nephron. Inside of the lumen is positive with respect to interstitium only at two sites. Later part of proximal tubule and thick ascending limb. Rest of the nephron have lumen negative transepithelial electrical gradient. Later part of proximal tubule is electropositive because negatively charged chloride is reabsorbed more than positively charged sodium. Thick ascending limb is electropositive because of diffusion of positively charged potassium from cell into the lumen and diffusion of negatively charged chloride from cell into the interstitium. Rest of the lumen is electronegative because of active reabsorption of positively charged sodium. In short, just remember that inside of the lumen is positive at only two sites, later part of proximal tubule and thick ascending limb. If you remember this much, you won't have any difficulty regarding transepithelial electrical gradient. Now let's see importance of apical tight junctions. First, they determine paracellular leakiness of tubular epithelium. The more the tight junctions, the less leaky the epithelium is. In general, leakiness decreases from proximal tubule to collecting duct. One important utility of this varying leakiness is in concentrating the urine. You will understand this when we see reabsorption of water. Now second, they help in maintaining ion transport in one direction. Let's see how. Here are the apical tight junctions. These are the transport proteins involved in reabsorption of sodium. Now cell membrane is fluidic in nature. So membrane bound proteins are freely moving along the membrane. Tight junctions limit this movement. So transporters cannot go beyond the junctions and are confined to the one side of the cell. This is very important in maintaining ion transport across the cell in specific direction. For example, here sodium ions are moving from lumen into the interstitium because sodium potassium ATPase pumps are confined to the basolateral membrane and sodium channels are confined to the luminal membrane. Now just assume that the tight junctions are not there. In this situation, all the transport proteins will spread over the entire membrane. Now see the movement of sodium here. All the transport proteins are still working, but control over the direction is lost. Thanks to tight junctions for preventing this, and thank you all for watching this video. If you find this video helpful, please share it with your colleagues and subscribe for more videos. See you in next video.